Ignition sequence starts.
Good morning. You have a great view of Mission Control Houston and the International Space Station Flight Control Room. That's the Orbit 2 team of flight controllers on console right now, settling into business as usual with a renewed crew of six astronauts and cosmonauts on board. Commander Oleg Skripochka and flight engineers Drew Morgan and Jessica Meir opened the hatch to welcome three new crewmates on board for a week of joint operations and handover before they get in their Soyuz vehicle to return to Earth, leaving Expedition 63 to begin on orbit.
Welcome to Space to Ground. I'm Catherine Clayton. While many of us are processing the changes brought on by the COVID-19 pandemic, the International Space Station stays busy with the release of the SpaceX Dragon and the arrival of the Expedition 63 crew. On Tuesday, the SpaceX Dragon was released from the station for its return to Earth. Robotic flight controllers at Mission Control in Houston issued the commands to release the Dragon using the station's Canada Arm 2. Dragon splashed down in the Pacific Ocean, southwest of Long Beach, California. The cargo vehicle returned with more than 4,000 pounds of space station hardware and science. Some of the investigations returning to Earth for further analysis include bionutrients, which would allow the on-demand production of nutrients needed during long-duration spaceflight, and the biofabrication facility, which aims to 3D print human organ tissues in space. This week, the International Space Station crew grew to six with the arrival of the Expedition 63 crew. NASA astronaut Chris Cassidy and Roscosmos cosmonauts Anatoly Ivanishin and Ivan Wagner launched from Russia's Baikonur Cosmodrome in a Soyuz MS-16 on Thursday. They joined Expedition 62 commander cosmonaut Oleg Skripochka and NASA astronauts Andrew Morgan and Jessica Meir. Cassidy will become Expedition 63 commander once the Expedition 62 crew returns home next week. The crew members of Expedition 63 are set to be on board to welcome NASA astronauts Bob Behnken and Doug Hurley, who will arrive on NASA's SpaceX Demo 2 flight test. Keep sending in your questions using the hashtag AskNASA, and we'll see you next week.
Here's a quick rundown of our coverage of the International Space Station Crew Exchange and Soyuz operations coming up on NASA TV and NASA.gov. On Wednesday afternoon, April 15th, we'll see Expedition 62 Commander Oleg Skripochka in a ceremonial handover of command of the space station to Expedition 63 Commander Chris Cassidy. Early Thursday evening, April 16th, Skripochka, Drew Morgan, and Jessica Meir float into their Soyuz spacecraft and close the hatch behind them to make final preparations for departure. Then our coverage of undocking operations begins at 8:30 p.m. Central Time. And our coverage of landing operations begins at 11 p.m. Central Thursday. Soyuz landing in Kazakhstan should happen about 12:17 next Friday morning. Our coverage will show you a lot of the highlights of a crew return to Earth, but we'll see it from the outside of the Soyuz vehicle. What's it look like for the departing crew members as they leave their home on orbit to return to the home planet? If you got 60 seconds, here's an insider's view of what a trip to Earth on a Soyuz spacecraft looks like.
Soyuz MS spacecraft with non-stop service for Kazakhstan. Our flight time will be just under 3 hours 30 minutes. We'll be descending from an altitude of over 1,300,000 feet. At the time of departure, we're flying at a ground speed of 17,500 miles per hour. Please make sure all carry-on items are secured and that your seatbelt is correctly fastened. Now sit back, relax, and enjoy the flight. Ladies and gentlemen, we are now entering the upper levels of Earth's atmosphere. The estimated temperature outside is over 5,000 degrees Fahrenheit. During this zone of turbulence, we recommend you keep your seatbelt fastened while you're seated. As we start our final descent, our speed is down to 24 feet per second. At 1 second before touchdown, engines on the bottom of the vehicle will fire to soften the landing. On behalf of the entire crew, I'd like to thank you for flying with us. Welcome to Kazakhstan.
When that Soyuz undocks next week, Expedition 63 begins with astronaut Chris Cassidy as station commander. Cassidy is a U.S. Navy captain, earned a bachelor's degree in math at the Naval Academy and a master's in ocean engineering from MIT. And he served 11 years as a Navy SEAL with 4 overseas deployments before becoming a NASA astronaut. But you never really know someone, do you, until you know their favorite musical instrument and what they hope to be remembered for. Cassidy shed light on these things and more as the clock counted down to his 3rd trip to space.
The clock has started. Roger.
What is your favorite season?
Fall.
What's your favorite constellation?
Orion.
Favorite musical instrument?
The viola.
The viola?
Only because my kids played it.
Morning or night person?
Morning.
One thing you're afraid of?
Screwing up on a space mission.
One thing you have in the refrigerator at all times?
Pesto.
What's your favorite book?
The Count of Monte Cristo.
Favorite movie?
Saving Private Ryan.
Favorite dance move?
The sprinkler.
What's your favorite color?
Navy blue.
Guilty pleasure?
Eating ice cream.
The accomplishment you are most proud of?
Being the honor graduate of SEAL training.
The next item on your space bucket list?
Welcoming one of the commercial crews on board the space station.
Advice that you would give to younger you?
Communicate more often.
Who inspires you?
Anybody that does unsolicited, unselfish acts.
What would you like to be remembered for?
Having the greatest NBA 3-point percentage.
The International Space Station is designed to be a laboratory in space that can provide benefits on Earth and teach humankind the things we need to know to be able to explore beyond low Earth orbit in the years to come, including returning to the Moon in just a few years. A couple of recent experiments on the station are building on all of those goals.
Cementing our place in space. Presented by Science at NASA. As your dog drags you around the block for his morning walk, you're probably not thinking about the wonders of the neighborhood sidewalk. But that concrete is pretty great. Next to water, it's the most widely used material on Earth. In the future, concrete may be equally useful off the planet, when humans construct a permanent base on the Moon. They'll need sturdy stuff that can weather bombardments from solar radiation and meteorites. No one wants a crack in their moon base. The key to making out-of-this-world concrete may be to study it out of this world. 2 experiments have taken place aboard the International Space Station, or ISS, to do just that. The microgravity investigation of cement solidification, or MIX, and multi-use variable G processing facility, or MVP cell 05. Researchers from Pennsylvania State University and NASA's Marshall Space Flight Center are analyzing the study's results. Concrete is a mixture of sand, gravel, and rocks glued together by cement paste made of water and cement powder. And it's not as mundane as it looks. Under the surface, it's quite complex. What goes on there is key to its strength and durability. Yet scientists still don't understand all the details of concrete's chemistry and microscopic structure. Processing methods aren't cast in stone. There's plenty of room for improvement. Alexandra Radlinska, principal investigator for both experiments, says, "Our experiments are focused on the cement paste that holds the concrete mixture together. We want to know what grows inside cement-based concrete when there is no gravity-driven phenomenon, such as sedimentation. It all begins when water is added to the cement. To put it very simply, the cement's molecular structure changes when the cement grains dissolve." Radlinska explains, as the old molecules dissolve, calcium silicate hydrate and calcium hydroxide start to crystallize. Myriads of these tiny crystals form all through the mixture, interlocking with one another and with the other concrete ingredients, such as gravel. The ISS experiments are researching how this all plays out in space. Radlinska says it could change the distribution of the crystalline microstructure and ultimately the material properties. The ratio of the water cement powder is critical to making the concrete components combine effectively and determining the strength and durability of the final concrete. Will this ratio need to be different on the moon, where gravity is about 1/6 of Earth's? That's the kind of question the experiment will shed light on. For the mix experiment, astronauts added water to a series of packets containing dry cement powder, then added alcohol to some of the packets to stop the hydration process at specified times. For MVP cell 05, astronauts also hydrated dry cement, but for this experiment, they used a centrifuge on board the ISS to simulate gravity at a number of strengths, including lunar gravity and Martian gravity. For both experiments, the samples were returned to Earth for analysis. "We're already seeing and documenting unexpected results," says Marshall's Richard Grugel, co-principal investigator for MVP Cell 05. Radlinska adds, "What we find could lead to improvements in concrete both in space and on Earth. Since cement is used extensively around the world, even a small improvement could have a tremendous impact. We might even end up with better sidewalks for walking our dogs." For more from the International Space Station, go to www.nasa.gov/iss-science. For information about other weighty matters, visit science.nasa.gov.
Being the hands in hands-on science research is just a part of the job description for an International Space Station crew member. The astronauts and cosmonauts also spend some of their time sharing the experience of being in space with us Earthlings, and they talk to students about key scientific concepts. In this demonstration video, astronaut Mark Vandehei focused on Newton's third law of motion.
Welcome to the International Space Station. I'm NASA astronaut Mark Vandehei. Today, we're going to talk about Newton's third law. How do you think it will hold up in microgravity?
For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. This means that in every interaction between two objects, there are a pair of opposite forces acting on each object at the same time. A force pair. You can see that there are many examples on Earth. In space, thrusters expel one way and the vehicle is steered in the opposite way.
Hello again. More basketball stunts that I can't do on the ground, at least not while getting this much hang time. All right, back to serious business. Got a basketball right here. It's going to be object one. I'm the second object. If object two, myself, applies a force to object one, then that same force will be applied, according to Newton's third law, by object one onto object two. However, there's a big disparity in the mass. Object one is a very light mass object. Object two, myself, is a larger mass object. So I'm gonna try to make myself about the same shape as this ball. See how that works for us. And I'm gonna apply that force. You saw that force applied to the ball made it accelerate quite a bit. It really didn't accelerate me much at all. Newton's third law again, but this time we're gonna use two similarly massed objects. Joe and I have about the same mass, so Joe, get into a ball, I'll do the same. I'm gonna face you this way so that I don't throw you into something you can't see.
Right.
Now I'm gonna get into a ball behind Joe, and I'm gonna apply a force to him. Notice that when I applied a force to Joe, it accelerated Joe away from me, but I got accelerated away from him as well, because the force applied to Joe ended up being the same force that was applied to me. Now you've seen Newton's third law in space. Now test it out on Earth. See you next time.
Mm-hmm.
Although Chris Cassidy is a veteran astronaut, he spent many months in training to prepare for this International Space Station mission. It's the sort of training that also awaits those of his colleagues who will take part in the Artemis program missions that will return astronauts to the moon by 2024. Actors Kelly Marie Tran and Naomi Ackie from the film Star Wars: The Rise of Skywalker spent a day at NASA's Johnson Space Center late last year and worked with astronauts Megan MacArthur and Jessica Watkins on a few of the pieces of cool training equipment that get our astronauts ready for their missions off the Earth. Take a look.
Hey, how are you doing?
My name's Naomi Ackie.
And my name's Kelly Marie Tran. And we're at NASA's Johnson Space Center.
Mm-hmm. And we're training to be astronauts.
No big deal. Not big deal at all. We got this.
Come on, let us do it.
Let's go.
The first thing we're going to show you this morning is what's called a gravity offload system. So people often think that we have a room here where you can go in and flip a switch and suddenly you're floating. That's not really how it works.
You want to see how it works when you're 1/6 your weight or 3/8 your weight? We use Argos to do that. And then we use it to work on like new tools, new geology, sampling procedures.
So from here, what we do, we'll lift you up off the ground.
Oh my God!
And we'll put you into lunar gravity. Alright, so this right here is zero gravity. So if you're on a space station and I were to push you and say, see ya, you're just gonna put it away the way I push you.
So what did you guys think of that?
It was so cool. I was saying I realize now why astronauts walk like this.
Yeah!
Because everyone's just like trying as much as possible.
Do you guys want to go check out suits?
Yeah!
Want to go try some on?
Next. So we're going to talk to you a little bit about spaces today.
Yeah.
We're going to move some suits over here, I think, real quick, and we'll talk to you a little bit about what they are, and then we're going to let you guys change and actually try some out.
So you go out there, and there's no air.
Mm-hmm.
So then there's pressure pushing in on your body?
So what we would have to go through is your body would want to expand out, so that's why we wear a suit around us that goes through and creates an artificial atmosphere.
Do you guys have training in terms of how quickly you can get in and out of these? Is that a thing or not?
No, like, I mean, you have to know your spacesuit really well, but we don't do drills like getting in them quickly. You typically are helping each other getting into and out of them when you're in space.
And so those tubes actually are going to create cold water to help us cool and see what that feels like once you get inside. These guys are going to help you get climbing.
Yeah,
hi,
like
Chewy. The guy who plays Chewbacca.
Really?
Oh, this is so cool.
Stand up.
Well, unfortunately, we're going to get you guys out of the suit now, but then we're going to take you over and just see the vehicle that you would be in the suits in.
Okay.
The Orion vehicle.
This is the space launch system. This is what's going to push this capsule. This is the Artemis 1. This is going to go to the moon about 1 year from now.
Yes.
This is awesome. Oh my gosh.
Yes.
Okay, nine it.
This is the docking hatch up here. When we get to the gateway, we will dock at that port, and there will be a hatch up there that we open to go into
which
the gateway.
Which you have to target, right? So you have to figure out a way to drive the rocket so that the holes match up.
Bingo. You know how precise it is? First of all, relative to the Earth, we're going over 20,000 miles an hour, and when we dock, meet up with this plus or minus 1 inch, plus or minus 1 degree in each axis.
Really difficult.
Yeah, we actually make the switches, it's a multi-step so you don't accidentally hit a switch.
We're gonna go check out the mock-ups for the space station, which will seem luxuriously large.
Okay.
This gives you an idea of how big of a room each person gets, so you can put up your personal
effects.
So you do, you have a sleeping bag, as they mentioned, and you can pin that to the wall, and you can float kind of inside your sleeping bag.
That's
you can
so
tighten
cool.
it down if you would like to feel a little bit more stable.
This is Houston.
Yes.
This is when they actually say Houston, we have a problem. This is Houston.
So that's live.
They're in space right now. I just, oh my gosh, it's mad.
What's the day-to-day like in this room?
Yeah.
So in this room, we have three shifts a day.
My favorite shift is the night shift because it's when nobody's in this building, but we get to hang out with the crew.
Are you guys ready to try some space food?
Yes.
That's next on the list.
Where do you get the suggestions of what to work on next?
That's a great question. We get a lot from the crew office.
Or the crew office says, can we move away from red meat and potatoes and get Brussels sprouts, butternut squash? And this comes from a lot of crew comments as well as input from the nutrition line here at JSC that says, you guys should probably go with the salt in there. So on station, the astronauts have a much more advanced dehydration apparatus.
Okay.
They have the potable water dispenser. The astronauts can help you with figuring out how to unlock the straw.
Release this.
Great.
Otherwise, so that way when you set it down, liquid's not going to come up on how it's going to do it.
Stuff is at the bottom, so you want to like.
Right. She knows the tricks. The tricks of the trade game.
Which one is your favorite?
I would say the butternut squash is my favorite. But I like things that are sweet.
Mm-hmm. I like the Brussels sprouts, I think.
Mm.
They're so good.
All right, well, you guys have had your afternoon snack. Now you're ready to go drive a lunar rover?
Mm-hmm.
All right, let's go check it out.
I really don't know how to drive. Is this like going to be a
teacher?
What is that? Oh, is it here?
Ooh, it's air conditioned.
It's air conditioned?
Twist.
Yep.
This is so cool.
On the lunar surface, it'll basically be, you're in the rover, like Megan and Jessica will be in the rover for up to 14 days living together. And there'll be another rover, they'll go out for 14 days and explore. And if one breaks down, all four of you will jump in one vehicle.
I think I made contact.
Yeah.
We're there.
Awesome.
Yeah, we're there.
Yeah.
That was smooth.
Yes. That was awesome. What an amazing day.
It's been really good. It's been amazing. It's more than I expected.
Yeah.
I just have so much respect for NASA.
Same.
Yeah. Thank you for bringing
us
here.
NASA.
There have been 62 expeditions to the International Space Station since the year 2000, with more to come. And all of them have worked to achieve scientific goals while getting humankind ready for our next step in space exploration. That is, to move out beyond low Earth orbit, to return to the Moon by 2024, and then out into the solar system, to Mars. NASA is building the systems right now that will take us to our next destination.
50 years ago, we pioneered a path to the moon. The trail we blazed cut through the fictions of science and showed us all what was possible. Today, our calling to explore is even greater. To go farther, we must be able to sustain missions of greater distance and duration. We must use the resources we find at our destinations. We must overcome radiation, isolation, gravity, and extreme environments like never before. These are the challenges we face to push the bounds of humanity. We're going to the moon to stay by 2024, and this is how.
This all starts with the ability to get larger, heavier payloads off planet and beyond Earth's gravity.
For this, we design an entirely new rocket.
The Space Launch System. SLS will be the most powerful rocket ever developed.
And with components in production.
And more in testing.
This system is capable of being the catalyst for deep space missions.
We need a capsule
that can support humans from launch
through deep space and return safely back to Earth.
For this, we've built Orion.
This is NASA's next generation human space capsule.
Using data from lunar orbiters that continue to reveal the moon's hazards and resources,
we're currently developing an entirely new approach to landing and operating on the moon.
Using our commercial partners to deliver science instruments and robotics to the surface, we are paving the way for human missions in 2024.
Our charge is to go quickly and stay, to press our collective efforts forward with a fervor that will see us return to the moon in a manner that is wholly different than 50 years ago.
We want lunar landers that are reusable,
that can land anywhere on the lunar surface.
The simplest way to do so is to give them a platform in orbit around the moon from which to transition.
An orbiting platform to host deep space experiments and be a waypoint for human capsules. We call this lunar outpost Gateway.
The beauty of the Gateway is that it can be moved between orbits.
It will balance between the Earth and Moon's gravity
in a position that is ideal for launching even deeper space missions.
In 2009, we learned that the moon contains millions of tons of water ice.
This ice can be extracted and purified for water. It can be separated in oxygen for breathing or hydrogen for rocket fuel.
The moon is quite uniquely suited
to prepare us and propel us to Mars and beyond.
This is what we are building.
This is what we're training for.
This we can replicate throughout the solar system.
This is the next chapter of human space exploration.
Humans are the most fragile element of this entire endeavor, and yet we go for humanity. We go to the moon and on to Mars to seek knowledge and understanding and to share it with all. We go knowing our efforts will create opportunities that cannot be foreseen. We go because we are destined to explore and see it with our own eyes. We turn towards the moon now, not as a conclusion, but as preparation, as a checkpoint toward all that lies beyond. Our greatest adventures remain ahead of us. We are going.
We're going.
We are going.
We are going.
We're going.
If you'd like another look at the stories we featured today, and who could blame you, check us out on YouTube and Facebook. There are the addresses right there on your screen. And while you're there, be sure to look not only at what we showed you today, but all the other cool stuff that you can find about NASA and America's human spaceflight program. And if you're going to be out on the internet anyway, you should check out Houston, We Have a Podcast, especially this week. That podcast is where we talk to folks about their work in all aspects of space exploration. And we post new episodes every Friday. Today, as NASA recognizes the 50th anniversary of one of its most successful failures, the mission of Apollo 13, Gary Jordan has a special conversation with the two surviving crew members, Apollo astronauts Jim Lovell and Fred Hayes. I was there. It was pretty cool. Go to nasa.gov/podcasts for today's episode. It's where you can also find all of our previous episodes and the full library of all the NASA podcasts, all of which you can also listen to on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and SoundCloud.